that's a dark moment. Something has to change.
Hello, hello. Welcome back to the Wild Business Growth Podcast presented by Hippo Direct. This is your place to hear from a new entrepreneur or innovator every single Wednesday morning who's turning wild ideas into wild growth. I'm your host, Max Branstetter, digital marketing dude at Hippo Direct, and you can reach me at max@hippodirect.com for help using your podcast as a marketing tool. This is episode number 72, and today's guest is Kris Ward. She's a time management expert and is the amazing author of Win the Hour, Win the Day. You'll learn how to get better at managing your time, why you should not use a to-do list, and the incredibly inspiring life lessons that Kris has to share. It's literally about time. Enjoy the show. Alrighty, we are here with Kris Ward, the time management expert, the amazing author of Win the Hour, Win the Day. Kris, you were early for this interview. How do you do it? How are you doing today?
I'm doing awesome. And I firmly believe if I'm on time, I'm late. So I'm a little bit of a always get there early and be prepared kind of game.
if it's you versus time in a boxing match, I'll take you any day.
Oh, thank you.
this is really neat. We connected, and the more I heard about you and your backstory, I was just blown away. You are tackling something that literally everyone deals with, and I think so many people just kind of take as, you know, there's only so many hours in a day, and that's kind of how it is. But you've really taken the bull by the horns there. But I have a very important first question for you. Do you wear a watch?
I don't.
Oh,
great question.
Me neither. Why is that?
Well, I have my phone, and I guess I set up my day. We'll dive into this, but like when I sit down to do my work for the day, the first thing I do is I dictate, and I won't say her name. I say, hey, you know, my phone. And then I tell her to set timers so she doesn't go off. And I tell her to set timers throughout the day for all my appointments so that I can be totally into what I'm doing. Because even when you have a watch, if you're constantly in that alert of, oh my gosh, you know, yeah, I've been deep into this work. What time is it? You're splitting your energy. So I have little alerts that allow me to, you know, indicate to move forward.
And I know who you're talking about, She Who Must Not Be Named. We actually had Susan Bennett, the original voice of She Who Must Not Be Named, on the podcast previously. And there's mentions of the name in the episode that can sometimes trigger your phone.
Yes.
So.
yes.
So you are the expert. You're the queen of time. That's your official title, I'm sure. And we're going to get into a lot about time management and your book and your expertise and how people can improve their day and their workflow in that regard. But before we get to that, let's get to the land before time, if you will.
Okay. Sure.
So what were you doing? You know, what did your life look like before you zeroed in on this area of time? Because it's a pretty big switch, and it's a pretty big change to focus on this.
Yeah, I mean, that's a great question, because what I really want people to understand is I'm not just somebody that came out and said, hey, I'm organized, which we'll dive into later, by the way, works against you. But, you know, oh, look, I'm all about time management, and here's why, and I've got it all together. That's not the case. I want people to understand it was a painful, daunting journey to get here, and that my experience is based on my own business. So I have a marketing agency, and I was in business for about 4 years. And I just looked around one day and I thought, oh my gosh, like I'm working crazy, insane hours. And there didn't seem to be any indication that was slowing down. I always had this thing of once I get caught up, once this happens, once after the holidays, all these, there's always these, you know, indicators that it will be different. And, you know, I talk about this in the book where I almost electrocuted myself because I was in such a rush. And I now call myself now a recovering rushaholic. So I nearly electrocuted myself one day because I was in such a rush. And I thought, that's a dark moment. Something has to change. So I started to look at productivity, like just dive into it feverishly. And I was obsessed with it. But I also had a pushback with productivity and time management because I did get a lot done in a day. And I was the go-to person for a lot of people. It just seemed to me like, well, there's just too much work. It's not that I'm not organized or I don't get a lot done. I needed something different than what was out there because I did get a lot of stuff done and I didn't have time for heavy strategies or systems and all this stuff that you, as my clients say, by the time I put that all into my work, I could have just got the work done that I was neglecting or behind on. So I really wanted something that would give a simple and easy fix because I realized that I had been subscribing to the old way of doing things. I was just working harder and harder, buying new technology, thinking that would solve my problem. I was burning out. I was repeating the cycle and it just wasn't working. So I started to make some very simple strategies that were starting to yield me relief. And I started to examine a lot of stuff. And one of the biggest things I realized was the most successful people in the world, when they have these teams and support systems, I thought they got those because they had arrived and had achieved their success. But in fact, those people all viewed time differently as how they got there. So that was fascinating to me as well. So I really went from working like 16 hours a day down to 6 or 7. And I couldn't believe my productivity. I couldn't believe my creativity. I couldn't believe, you know, all the things I was learning. Like, you know, it was just fascinating that I had been in my own way all that time. And that you're really, when you're grinding it out, you're totally working against yourself, right? Like,
yeah.
So many levels, right? All the best inventions of mankind have come at times of relaxation, play, and creativity because your mind can't be racing and achieving the next obstacle and being creative at the same time. It doesn't work that way. So I did all that. It was really working for me. I was really feeling, you know, business should be fun. It was going really well. And the changes were all working. And luckily they did, because it was a couple years after that my husband had been diagnosed with colon cancer. And so I was pulled away from the business for over 2 years. And when I returned to the business after his passing, my business not only had survived, but it had thrived. And when it became public to my clients, they had no idea. They were shocked. They had no idea of my absence. They had no idea what I was going through. And so they started to gently ask me, you know, how did I do it? You know, how did I execute on that level? And so I wanted to help more people enjoy their business and all that type of stuff. So I started working with them and we started getting all kinds of results, and they were able to get rid of 80% of their to-do list, 100% of their guilt. They could stop doing things that they hated, that they didn't have time for. Make more money in less time, have a bigger impact on their audience. But the biggest thing of all is they started taking real vacations for the first time. And so I took all their successes and I thought, hey, let's help more people, because I do believe business should be fun. And that's how the book Win the Hour, Win the Day was born.
Holy cow. So first off, I mean, you've been through one of the most difficult things that anybody could ever possibly go through. And as opposed to letting it kind of repeatedly kick you down, you know, for the rest of your life, you have come out thriving and you've been able to build back up from that and somehow turn your business to the next level. So that's really an incredible thing there. And so I just want to know what was it about that tragic and terrible experience that allowed you to come out of there so strong and better and energized?
Well, that's a loaded question. So I guess I don't
yeah, three word answer.
Yeah, I guess, no. You know what? I try to be positive in all aspects of it. And my journey with John through that experience was also very positive. We decided that we didn't know how it was going to turn out. Even though they gave him a very grim diagnosis, we said two things are going to happen. They're going to be wrong, and we wasted 2 years moaning and crying about it, or they're right and we wasted the last 2 years moaning and crying about it and being fearful. So even with that, you know, I planned surprise birthdays for him. I took him to a trip to England to see family he hadn't seen in a while. So there's all these other things that we did too. But I guess I feel when the news first came out, and this was something I was very, very uncomfortable with at first sharing, especially in about the book and the podcast. And it wasn't because of the emotions attached to it, is because they didn't want people to change or their sympathy, right? And I say that with kindness. I love it when people care and they reach out to me, and I appreciate that. But what I also understand is everybody has something. This was my something right now. So everybody has interruptions in their life. Everybody has things that hurt or are difficult to get through. So, you know, I'm no different than anyone else. Everyone else has a story. And so how you navigate through that story at the highest level of efficiency and honor the people that support and care about you and, you know, put your best game out there is what I believe, you know, what I believe is what life is about. So that was I just thought, okay, everybody's got something. Let me honor him and do this the best that I can.
It's such a beautiful thing that you had that outlook and you guys handled everything that way. And I think, you know, it goes back to what you focus on a lot now with everything in the time management world, is that your outlook is spot on. That's really the best way to handle it, is when you get tragic and tough news like that, there's no point in wasting time or making it, you know, just as sad or depressing as possible. If anything, that is the time where you should make the most of your time and make it do all you can do with that timing. So you've, in everything you've made the most of the situation. And that's just very inspiring.
Well, thank you.
Of course. The other question I had about your background, because I can't just leave it there, is you mentioned you almost got electrocuted.
Yes.
Which I think is the first mention ever on this podcast about any type of electrocution.
Okay.
What were you doing that you almost got electrocuted?
Okay, well, let me tell you, the electrocution was the point for me, but there was a few serious kitchen fires where when, you know, your husband says to you really nicely and sits you down, specifically asks you not to burn the house down, that also is a problem. But
because, that might be a sign.
Yeah, because I would put something in the oven late at night because I'd get in late and I think, oh, I'm just going to check these two emails and blah, 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 and, you know, whatever. So that's a whole other story. But the electrocution was one morning I got up and I was rushing to get the doors, always rushing, 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 always rushing. And I was blow drying my hair and brushing my teeth at the same time. So the water's running, because why? Why would I do one thing at a time when I could do two things poorly? And I looked and I had 1,000 things going on my mind, like a bunch of file drawers open, all the things I was going to attack in the day. And I took a step forward to the sink and I realized at the last second I was about to put my blow dryer underneath the water, running water. And I thought, oh, this is, you need help. You need intervention. And I just thought, okay, this is it. Like I didn't even tell anybody about that at the time. Cause I thought, you know, I'm not going to be left alone. This is it. We have crossed to the dark side. And I thought this can't be the way you can't run a life like this.
Yeah. Yeah. Like lighthearted nature aside, that is a serious wake up call, and sounds like, yes, you had several wake up calls. Yes. So I can see how this became so crystal clear to you of how, you know, I really need to take a look at some things.
Yeah.
And now I'll know next time I'm blow drying my hair, because I do that all the time, to not run the sink water while I do it.
Yes. And you know what? It just was a bigger lesson that, you know, your business should support your life, not consume it. It should not be an interruption to your life. So that's the foundation of everything I do now, is teaching people business should be fun and it should support your life, not consume it.
Let's get to your focus today and time management, and we'll also get to your book, Win the Hour, Win the Day. So why time in general? I mean, you spoke through the backstory of why, yeah, you kind of realized this stuff was important, but what has inspired you to tackle this monster that is time, that literally, you know, really dictates the day for everyone?
Well, because I think if productivity is your superpower, you can literally do anything, like absolutely anything. And I think it's also the one thing that no matter how sophisticated your academia background is, you were not taught this. Like you could be at the highest level of education and you've got a bunch of professors giving you demands based on their needs. And they're not saying, hey, how are you coordinating that work with the other aspects of your courses or your home life, or are you working and all, you know, do you have family demands? They're not doing that. So no one really taught us to look at how to integrate all these aspects of your life for success. Like we just don't have that roadmap out there. And there's some stuff out there, but they're just really heavy weighted infrastructures. So I think looking at your time bank account, which is your calendar, is a really powerful thing. And most people just are not using their calendar or understanding the grasp of time effectively. I know for me, for years, I just thought you go faster, you try to race time, you try to outrun it. And that is, we've clearly established, does not work.
That analogy of a bank account is spot on. Can you explain that a little bit more? Because I think when you think of time and you compare it to a financial sense, it really helps to internalize everything.
Yeah. So here's an example. I often talk to people about how they navigate through their day, right? And what's your GPS for the day? And your time bank account is everything. And so at the very least, you need to be having the things that you do every day on your calendar, right? We've all put external appointments on our calendar. Like, it doesn't matter how much we don't like the dentist, how expensive or how much it hurts. If we have a dental appointment on the calendar, we get there. But then we don't put our work on the calendar, and we don't especially put our work that we do every day. People say to me, well, Kris, I do that every day. I don't need that on the calendar. I don't need to be reminded of that. But that's like saying, I have a car payment that comes out every month. I know it comes out, so I don't count it as an expense. That money is gone. We know that. We accept that. So on the calendar, when you're not putting stuff on your calendar that you do have to do every day and you're not counting it as work, before you even, you know, sit down at your desk, you are at a deficit because you might think you have 8 or 9 hours. And in fact, you maybe have 4 because you're not counting, you know, the inventory that's already there. So that's a huge problem. And you really set yourself up to fail.
Yeah, it's funny because everybody's so, you know, there's so much debate about how many hours a day people should be working and this and this and this. But so many of those hours are things that people often aren't really planning for, or they know that they're doing, but because they don't have it on their calendar, they think they have so much more time during the day, and that's just not the case.
Absolutely. So they're trying to figure out where their time went instead of planning where it's going.
Bam. And as we know, you are ahead of the curve. So let's get to sort of the basics here. If you're thinking about productivity and time management, and you're looking to make some changes, what are some basic things that anybody can do that are crucial and can really help to organize and better your day from a productivity standpoint?
Well, there's a number of things. So I want to make sure I at least mention two. And one is, I would tell you the to-do list is just the absolute worst thing you can do for any business. To-do lists do not have increments of time. They don't have a sequence. All they are is a list of items with a percolating sort of sense of emergencies on there. So when you neglect them, the emergencies will rise to the top. They're not something that will allow you to leverage your time or hand off to somebody else. It just doesn't happen, right? A to-do list is not in any successful business. Like, you know, you don't ask a FedEx driver who's taking an organ to a hospital, like, you got the address, right? Do you have your list? You know, that's not how it goes, right? So a to-do list is absolute guarantee for problems, if not failure. Right? So that's a problem right there. And then people say, well, what do? Well, you need these things to be actionable items. They need to have a place on your calendar. You need to say, here's a plan. I mean, think about it like if you were going on a road trip, say from New York to California, and I know I would definitely use my GPS. It would tell me what time I would get there. It would instantly tell me when I was off course. You know, you wouldn't be driving along going, should I have taken that exit 2 hours ago? That's the best part, is it would tell you immediately when you're off course, and it would tell you how long the trip is and with all the great details. If you planned and had a to-do list for that same trip, what you'd have is things like bring money, gas money, clothes, snacks. That doesn't talk about the efficiency of the trip. And so if you'd want that for a road trip, wouldn't you want that for your business? So the first thing I would tell you is you do need to be using that calendar, and you got to stop using to-do lists.
Yeah, that's spot on. A quick aside on GPS. This is going to sound very millennial of me, but I cannot believe that people used to go around and do trips like cross-country trips, but even just trips to, you know, a state over or two without GPS in the past. I mean, it obviously happened. We got where we are today, but it is so helpful. Like I got, once I started using GPS fully and at my previous job when I drove to work,
I literally started using GPS all the time because you want to check Google Maps or Waze for traffic and see what's quicker. So anyway, you can apply that same philosophy to your day. It's just helpful to have that extra knowledge there. So again, with the analogy, so you really, you're the analogy expert as well here.
We're trying. So the, you know, if you want another thing, the other thing I would tell you, and this is something that most people just, it warps their brain when I say it, but what I would tell you is to do the creative work first. So, you know, most people dive into their emails first thing in the morning. What happens is you, first of all, have external outside forces dictating your day. And think of it like a battery of your phone fully charged. What you do is you deplete the battery quicker by having, you know, a whole bunch of apps open. And that's what happens when you go into emails. You get attention deficit, you get, sorry, attention residue, and decision fatigue and all these things that take your brain in different directions. And you need yourself fully charged to get the best creativity and focus out of your work. So for example, I don't know if you know, but we've recently launched a podcast. It's called Now Your Business.
Yes. And what happened, congrats on that.
Thank you. So what happened with my team is once I was convinced that we should do this, I said, okay, great. Let's do it in the spring. And I had a date and my team said, well, you have a speaking gig in a couple weeks, 3.5 weeks. Why don't we do it then? You'll be in front of a crowd. And I'm like, huh, that sounded great on paper, but I had the marketing. I have the marketing agency. I have Win the Hour clients. I have a full load, right? So of course they threw it back on me and said, well, let's use, you know, like we do everything else. We'll use the strategies. Like this is how we do it. What's the problem? So you can't argue when they're using that against you and it's your book. So I said, okay, let's try that. So one of the things I did was every morning, the first hour, I made sure went to Now Your Business. And I did my, you know, where I was freshest, where I was most creative, where I was be able to learn and implement and get those things up. Because, you know, I can do the stuff that I'm doing all the time or the emails later because I need my freshest zone first thing in the morning. So I did that. And I did Now Your Business stuff every morning for an hour for 3 weeks. And we also had like 8 guests in our launch because, you know, and they were, some of them were of significant weight as far as influence goes. So you can, I can assure you I was going around their calendar. They weren't going around mine, you know, so I had to do all those interviews. And plus I didn't even know how to load it to iTunes and, you know, all this stuff that I didn't know that I didn't know cover.
Graphic. Oh, you should have reached out to me. I could help you with that.
Yeah. Well, we,
anyway,
the point is we learned as we needed to, but the point is when I signed up to do it, I didn't even know what was involved. But
right.
I did the creative work first every morning and we did. We launched it in 3.5 weeks and we were top 10 in our country and we broke records in, as far as I'm concerned, in other countries. And it was pretty awesome. But all I did was do the creative work first. And so you can really execute at a high level if you follow some simple strategies because the old me years ago, absolutely. When I took on a new challenge like that, you'd say, okay, I'm going to work really hard and see if I can finish my work by 3 or 4. And then I'm going to dive into that thing I really need to learn. So the idea of diving into some project that you need to learn is really important at the end of the day is just a fool's errand. Because first of all, you're exhausted. Things come up that interrupt it. The end of the day moves from 3 to 4 to 5 to 6, you know, and then you think, well, that doesn't happen. Well, I'll do double tomorrow. I've done that. So really, if you want to execute at a high level, when you're taking on something that's really important for you to have an impact on your audience and you want to meet a deadline, then you do the creative work first.
Yeah. It's great to hear because I find too, I often feel most fresh in the morning. And even if it's a week where I've had a couple late nights in a row and I know I'm going to be really, really tired later in the day, I know that in the morning, you know, I get my gym workout. Yeah. I get my workout in the morning. And after that, there's still a few hours there where you're still pretty fresh, even if you didn't get as much sleep as you usually do. So I like to, as you know, I like to schedule my podcast interviews for the morning, sometime in the morning, because I just feel in general, people are more fresh then and more energized and thoughtful. So I see where it comes from. How does that apply to the day of the week? So that's kind of like if you're focused on your creative stuff in the morning and kind of more thought involved stuff of the morning, regardless of the day, is there a difference when you do certain tasks on like a Monday or Tuesday versus towards the end of the week?
Yeah, that's a great question. Well, what I would say too is I firmly believe in batch work, right? So what I would say for me is I deal with all my clients or coaching calls on Thursdays. And so then I know Thursdays I'm going in one direction and, you know, boom, 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 it's one direction. And too many times people will say, well, you know, my clients, you know, have different schedules and I'll do a sales call and a client call, and then they're just going in a whole bunch of different directions. And that just doesn't work to the highest level of your efficiency. What I would say is when we talk about batch work, if you say to the first two appointments you have, like, okay, yeah, we're meeting on Thursday. And then the third person asks you for whatever, you say, hey, I've got a spot on Thursday. Can you do that? If you guide them, more often than not, it's all going to work out for you. So that's a big thing, is I would say you want to have batch work first off. And then secondly, you're right. I probably would not try to do a sales call Friday afternoon, not even just because of me, but because of the people I'm talking to, right? I just don't think they're at their best. Right. So I do keep those things in mind for sure. Yeah.
And I'm curious as well from the morning standpoint, as we're thinking about the actual time of the day and of the week here, I've seen a lot of people, and there's kind of a trend, and it might tie more towards, you know, veterans and people with military ties, but Jocko Willink comes to mind, for example. He's a retired Navy SEAL who's got a huge podcast now and close with Tim Ferriss and all those guys. Anyway, if you look at his social media pages, he literally posts every single morning at 4 a.m. or 4:20 or 4:30 his watch, because that's when he starts his workout in the morning. And his whole thing is that he wakes up at 4 a.m. every single day, literally every single day, no matter how much sleep he got, even if he only got a couple hours of sleep. So I'm curious your thoughts on that. Like, do you like to wake up early or feel the need to wake up early?
I do not. Well, here's the thing. Early is relative. So first of all, I do think I'm a morning person. And in the world I live in, people think I wake up early, meaning I tend to wake up between 6 and 7. I don't even have an alarm. If Ooh. Something was going really crazy and I really had a good sleep in on the weekend, it might be 8. So I tend to be, you know, consistent with that. But here's the other thing. I think sleep is absolutely hugely important. And I went without sleep for a couple of years in the beginning. And I look back now and it seems I lost a significant amount of my charm when I was exhausted all the time.
Oh, that, and, Kris, that's impossible with you. Come on.
Yes. And I know now they show studies that we know that you're emotionally volatile, you're sensitive, your reactions are much higher. You don't think as clearly. I mean, the brain is the brain. And I would see all these studies and stuff like that, but I thought somehow it didn't matter because I was so driven and cared so much about my business. But you know, you need the brain to think. When you're running your own business, when you're an entrepreneur, you need that brain. And so what I would tell you is that I think a structure is hugely important. Like even when I took on that task of launching our podcast in just a couple of weeks, the number one rule I had was everything has to stay within the structures. Like I have to work out in the morning. I have to stop for lunch. You know, I have to take care of myself because I consider myself a business athlete and you cannot abuse the machine, the only machine you have. Like, you know, somebody who is an Olympic athlete with skiers isn't going to like beat their skis around, right? They're going to take care of that. So I believe sleep is hugely important, but if you put the right things in place, you can really take care of that as one of the essential things you need to effectively run your business. So if he enjoys getting up at 4 a.m., great. That wouldn't work for me. But if things do come up where I had to learn, because I was always very driven by a calendar and obsessed about getting stuff done. So I had to learn, like, if for some reason I don't get to bed on time, I have given myself permission. Sleep comes before working out, because I would jump up and say, oh no, I got to get my workout in. I mean, it doesn't happen very often that I miss my workout, but I've had to learn that sleep comes before other things. Like, let's say I wasn't well or whatever reason I didn't get the sleep I wanted last night. I've had to learn to let go of stuff to make sure that sleep was a priority. So anyhow, I think I'm on a lecture here about sleep, but I think we minimize that as a culture. And it is, we know that people go crazy without sleep. Like I can't stress enough how important that is. So to me, that's a non-negotiable.
Yeah. And he's a bit of an extreme example. I mean, literally like retired Navy SEAL and awarded, but I think with sleep, it just goes back to how well you're managing your time, because the better you're doing that, then there's no need to, you know, stay up late multiple nights in a row during the week if you're being on top of it during the day. So I'm with you.
And yeah. And you'll get diminishing results when you start bleeding into the evening. I guarantee you. Then what happens is you think you're doing yourself a favor. I'm just going to work a little later tonight because it's really important. And then you just aren't quite as fresh in the morning. You start a little bit later and it just unravels.
It does. So some people use tools for sleep. So I want to get into the topic of tools in general for time management. And that was the award-winning segue brought to you by, no, I'm just kidding. So, So what tools do you like to use, you know, whether it's in terms of your calendar or just any sort of productivity tools you use, are there some favorites that you are like your go-tos?
Yeah, that's a great question. And what I want to preface that with is, what is a tool? So a tool is something that I believe can instantly make your work more efficient. So no tool is going to fix anything. So a microphone, as I speak into it, does not make me a better speaker. It makes you hear me more clearly, louder, but it doesn't make me more articulate, you know, or we would just spend more and more on the microphones, right? Mm-hmm. So
exactly.
So you have to remember, a tool can't fix your time management problem. That's number one you have to understand. Number two, in this age of technology and shiny object syndrome, I know I fell prey a number of times of, listen, if you just buy this system and this project management and blah, 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 in 3 months, you're going to put information in one end, it's going to come out the other. Oh my gosh, like the world's going to be, you know, an oyster for you. It's just going to be amazing, right? And I would spend all this time learning stuff, never mind the money I paid for it. And I would just have wasted that time and just been so frustrated months later. So for me, and what I tell my clients, and they see it instantly, is a tool is something that you can use within 5 minutes. If you can't learn it and use it within 5 minutes, it's not a tool, because a tool is something that leverages your time. If you have to learn how to do it, that's another project. That's something you're learning. That's not a tool.
That's some major irony there.
Yeah. Yeah. And we misuse the word tool. And the other thing I would tell you is, for myself and for the most, honestly, successful people in the world with all kinds of financial resources, all the best tools are either free or next to free. Yeah. So a lot of the stuff that I use is like this. I, you know, you're not going to be in one of my coaching calls and say, okay, great, you need money for this, you need money for that. It is free or so next to free, you don't even remember how much you paid for it. Right.
Right.
So here's an example of something I do. So I might do some batch work. Like this morning, I shot some videos for social media. So then what will happen is that 1 minute video, I will drop it in Temi, T-E-M-I.
Oh, yes. Love that. Yeah.
I will take Temi and then I will take the transcription, which is 10 cents a minute. So that's a not free, but next to free. So I spent 10 cents and then I have a transcription and then we just edit that a little bit and we use it as posts for social media. So I can usually get maybe 3 to 5 posts out of a 1 minute video because I use different pieces of it. And then often we'll take that and we'll just take the whole transcription, edit it a little bit, and I'll use it for a blog on LinkedIn. And we produce a blog every Thursday on LinkedIn. So for the 10 cents I spent, I repurposed my video that I shot, and I usually get a significant amount of material, maybe 3 to 7 posts out of it, and usually 2 articles.
That's so funny you mentioned Temi, because we use Temi ourselves for the transcripts for the podcast. So This is going to be like Temi-ception once that gets released. Yeah. But we've toyed with the idea, you know, in our company calls of saying, look, you know, it might be easier to create blog posts just by talking and doing the transcription than actually going through and typing it. And you're actually doing that. So that seems like it's been a positive experience for you.
Yes. And I encourage my clients to do that as well, because what happens is when you sit down to type something out, you try to sound like your speech is different than your dialogue, and you're typing and you're trying to sound articulate and academic and you don't come off as natural, and there's way more editing. So what I do often is I will just record myself talking on a topic, and then I will just come back after I put it in Temi and edit it. And it's much more efficient. It's much more closer to what I want to say, to who I am, because we all talk very different than we write. And it's much easier to edit something than it is to create something. So if you just talk it out for a minute and then you edit it, much faster process. So yeah, I always talk to my coaching clients about that as well.
I love that. We're going to have to start doing that. Yeah. It's brilliant. It's just so much easier to talk. And the more and more you get used to talking, which obviously you're used to talking, typing and writing just seems like such an effort. And as you were saying, it takes so much energy, brain energy to think of what to type and what to type. It's just talk. Why not?
Yeah. And we speak about 200 words per minute. A good typer types 50 words per minute.
Oh my God. I'm again, 3 words per 20 seconds. So,
yeah. So again, there's that. And plus we're just coming from a different part of the brain where we're trying to say, and hence, and therefore, and we're not, and we know with social media, the whole thing, people want to see you talking, even if it's written, you have to, you know, make it sound like it's conversational. So why, how better to make it sound conversational than have a conversation?
Yeah. That should be like the goal, the mission. We all strive just not to say hence when we talk.
Yes.
So a lot of the things that we've been discussing, you do cover in your book, Win the Hour, Win the Day. I just want to touch on that a little bit more. You know, so obviously this book came to you as you realize how valuable this method and the things that you were doing were for your business. What's the main thing you want people to take away when they read your book?
Well, the biggest compliment I get all the time is people tell me that it changes their mindset, that they look at everything completely different now. And I tell people that I often compare it to fitness. I say, you know, somebody who jumps up and loses 100 pounds and changes their lifestyle didn't just realize, oh my gosh, I should eat better and exercise. Oh, I wish somebody had told me. What happens is their mindset changed, right? So the biggest compliment I get is they're like, they come back and they go, oh. And I talk about in the book, are you a successful person or a struggler? And people say, oh, it's holding on so tight that I wanted to be a successful person, which by the way, is nothing to do with income. You could make a very healthy income and be a struggler. And then they go, now I see it. Okay. So it really instills a change of behavior for them and they view their business really differently. So that's the biggest takeaway from the book that people keep sharing with me. So it's really just, you know, understanding that you're not racing time, that I don't love the term time management, but that's the term that's out there. I would love to call it time empowerment. And just to fully understand, I like that. Again, yeah, if productivity could be your superpower, then anything in the world you want to do can be laid effectively on top of that foundation. So it's just the most important thing, I think, and yet we don't talk about it hardly at all. We don't train about it. And then the systems that are out there are very labor intensive and, well, we're going to do blue colors for this and all this heavy stuff. And it just seems overwhelming. Right. So I just want people, I think business should be fun. Life should even be more fun. I don't think you should have to pay a heavy price for having dreams. And I think everything should just get easier and easier.
I think so. I think anybody would agree with that. And the title, Win the Hour, Win the Day, the hour part is intriguing because it's kind of seems like such a small part of every day, but obviously is so important when you kind of extrapolate that. So what's the hour element there and why is that so important that you brought it to the title of the book?
Because what I used to tell people all the time, it's not what you do with your day, it's what you do with your hour. And because I would myself have a real false sense when I went into work in the morning, oh my gosh, especially Monday mornings, I would have my mighty to-do list in my hand and I would think this week's going to be different. I'm going to get so much done today. And then, you know, it would start to peter out on this hateful to-do list that I had where all of a sudden you don't realize that item number 2 takes 20 minutes, item number 3 takes 2 hours. And you know, by the afternoon, it all unravels and you think, okay, I'll stay later. I'll come in early tomorrow. And what happens is you have this false sense of time. And, you know, so if something takes up your time, you think you still have so much day left to deal with it. So for example, a couple weeks ago, something happened to my iPhone and I had to call Apple. And so then 45 minutes later, they fixed it, but I'd really lost an hour. Now, the old me would have went into hysterical Kris mode and tried to rush the rest of the day and just make everyone around me go faster and faster because I lost time. And yeah. I have learned that was not an effective process. So what I did was I looked at my calendar and said, okay, I lost an hour. What can I move? What can move from today to another day? What are my priorities? So then I looked at it and I saw something like, oh yeah, that would have been nice to get done today, but that can move till Friday. And then I proceeded the day calmly and was at the same level of efficiency because I had a clear idea of what my responsibilities were for that day. And when you don't break it down into hour segments, you don't know when you're off the rails. So because it's not mapped out in a time, you know, in any sort of time efficiency on your calendar, you just don't even know how long things take you, and you cannot improve what you don't measure. But more importantly than that is you don't know at 2 o'clock in the afternoon, should I be an item 5 or item 15, right, of this silly to-do list. So breaking your day down into hour segments really holds you accountable to that hour, and it allows you to course correct. It allows you to, moving forward, map your projects effectively, because now you know how long this takes and all that stuff. So, and also the brain works a certain way too. The brain needs rest about every 60 to 90 minutes. So there's a whole bunch that goes into that. But this diving in enthusiastically in the morning and just trying to run as fast as you can until you peter out at night, I've done it and it's not as effective.
No, I mean, who likes petering out? I mean, maybe if your name's Peter, but that's for another story.
So you finally decide to start a podcast. Congrats! You've never been more excited. But wait a sec. You quickly find out this is way more of a time commitment than you initially thought. You're going to need someone that has you covered behind the scenes. That's where I come in. Email me at max@hippodirect.com and let's get wild.
So let's switch gears a little bit. Let's get to a segment on inspiration and creativity. So think about kind of what you were talking about in the morning and how you like to do creative things in the morning. But in general, what do you do to stay creative and to keep your mind fresh?
You know what? If you are rested, if you are taking care of yourself, and all these things, your mind will be fresh. I believe you should start work every morning refresh and leave fresh. So if you're not just grinding it out and beating yourself up, you won't have to stay creative. It will just be there, because you'll get up every morning, you're rested, you've slept. When I used to start taking lunches, I had to learn how to chew slower, because the old days I would be shoving food down my gullet, you know, on hold on the phone, answering emails at the same time. Thinking, oh yeah, this isn't even multitasking, because, you know, I'm on hold. That doesn't count. Emails don't count. And of course I can chew and talk at the same time. So, you know, now to even take a break for lunch, I had to learn to chew food slower. Like, that was crazy. So when you just start treating yourself with respect and kindness, it just really pushes out creativity. Like, the creativity and the clarity that I had, and my clients tell me this all the time. They're like, oh my gosh, like you see things in pieces instead of like this big mass. It's kind of like cards, like 52 pickup. If you threw a deck of cards on the floor, how would you see all the numbers and the colors and clubs and spades and all that? But if somebody shows you one card at a time, you're like, oh, got it, right? So you don't have to put things in place to inspire creativity if you're taking care of the infrastructure, the strategies, yeah.
I have never heard anybody talk about changing their chewing for productivity processes. Yeah. So that's amazing.
Yeah.
How about outside of work? So it's obviously very important to stay fresh and to have that balance there and make sure you get enough sleep. What do you like to do in your free time outside of work? What sort of hobbies just keep you going?
Well, in the last year, I've sort of rediscovered bicycling. So I'm pretty passionate. I like to work out and take care of my body, my health. And I really have dove into it. I really enjoy bicycling now. So that's something that getting out with nature and just clearing your head and looking at something different, that really invigorates me. So I really enjoy that. And hobbies, I don't know if this counts as a hobby, but I'm a little bit of a, like, I'm obsessed about business. I love business documentaries or books or anything that's done at any level of excellence, I think comes down to business. So sometimes I'm surprised when I look at something, I'm like, I see the business aspect of this and other people are not seeing it. So I just find the machinery of business really fascinating.
We'll count it. We'll count it as a hobby.
Yeah.
Well, business as a hobby, or viewing things through the business lens. I think that's smart, astute. Hence, no, I'm just kidding. So what is it? Do you have an example of that you can share? Like something that maybe is kind of an everyday thing that you really thought about the business implications of it?
Well, I have two totally different concepts. One recently I had watched on Netflix, they had this like behind the scenes of Formula One. And I knew like nothing in the world about that whatsoever. I didn't even know. I cannot stress how much I didn't know about this. But when I started watching it, what I didn't understand was like, I mean, I just have a bunch of cars going around in laps. I'm like, I don't get what they're getting. I don't get this. But when they showed the behind the scenes stuff and the fact that not only do they have to move the car, but like more computers than I've ever seen in my life, telling you the air pressure of every tire and the speed and how the tires are wearing down, all this craziness from Australia to like Mexico next weekend, you're like, oh my, like, you know, that talk about infrastructure and talk about not using a to-do list. Like that's insanity. Right. Yeah. And I was like, wow, like that is just crazy. I didn't get that. I didn't see the profoundness of how much like infrastructure and work and systems and money in just moving from location to location, never mind if your car goes fast or not. Right.
Oh my God. Yeah. That's crazy.
I know when you watch this documentary, you're just like, I have a whole new respect for that now. So there's that. And then one day I was switching channels and I tripped across one of these channels where they had one of these moms that had like, five babies at once, you know, and, quintuplets, and she was packing for a vacation, and I all of a sudden I stopped and I realized, you know, five times everything. She was going for 6 days. So she needed 36 outfits. She needed like something like 200 diapers and she had to put them in Ziplocs. And
200 and, diapers?
Yeah, because you had to do how many diapers a day, yeah, and blah, 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 time to do the math. And then she put them in Ziplocs. She labeled the bag. And I realized, man, she could run an empire when she gets these kids off to school. Like she had, you know, she had to have all these things in place just to get out the door. And I realized that's a whole business. So I was fascinated by that aspect of it. So yeah, I always see those kind of things.
Those are two completely opposite examples, yeah, but I love it. It's cool. It's like you're kind of what you're saying, like your mind kind of connects things from a creativity standpoint or puts things together when you're relaxing. Like even when you're just chilling, watching something, you are find yourself thinking about the ins and outs and all the details from that perspective. So that's amazing. I'll tell you what, I will never look at diapers the same way again. And I will never look at the air pressure in tire pressure in Formula One racing the same way
again. Yeah.
You know, because I do that all the time. So let's get to a fan favorite segment called the Wild Business Shout Out of the Week.
The Wild Business Shout Out of the Week.
Okay.
I know it's very impressive. Wild Business Shout Out of the Week. This is where we talk about a recent brand or campaign that caught your attention. And there's something, you know, speaking of Formula One, who has Winners, there's something about the clothing store and brand Winners that caught your attention. Do you mind taking us through that?
Yeah, they've got a commercial out right now for Christmas and it's pretty cool. I wish I had it memorized a little bit better, but what they're doing is they're spoofing off the fact that, you know, offline shopping. So they're all the things that people sell you on online shopping and the efficiency. Winners has people going through the store picking up stuff and they'll pick something up, put it in the cart, and they'll say that we have no tech issues with the cart because you just threw the item in the cart and there's no charge for shipping because there is no shipping, and they got 3D touching and they show them touching stuff. So they've got all of these really neat things that are counter, you know, intuitive to sort of marketing, but they're showing off the features of like as if offline shopping was now new. So they've done amazing job at the humor of it all. Yeah.
I like that. I like when when brands and the agencies that they're often working with are take an approach to something where they really kind of blur the lines or bend the lines in between offline and online. On a similar note, kind of in a similar vein, there was something I saw with Stella, and I think it was VaynerMedia behind it, but Stella, where they were talking about their glass of Stella, the beer, and they were promoting it as if it was a new cell phone, a new smartphone, your new handheld device, and how, you know, it's all these different features and how it can provide hours of entertainment all in the palm of your hand, all that sort of thing. So it's the same sort of idea, but I think when brands are able to make connections that way, it just bodes really well because it also shows that they have a sense of humor and they're not taking themselves too seriously.
Yeah. It was fun. It was, and some might want to be fearful and say, well, you know, Winners, you can also buy stuff online as well. What if they think we don't have online? Like, it'd be so easy to come from a fear-based position saying, mm-hmm, oh, we're going to look old school. We don't have online, but we do have online. Right. So I really appreciate their confidence in it as well.
Yeah. It's a good one. So I'm glad it stood out to you. So only a couple quick segments here to wrap up. So let's get to a segment called The Unusual. So pet peeves, quirks, and weird talents. We're going to get weird. We're going to get unusual. So what is your biggest pet peeve?
I try to be really positive, but I will say my pet peeve is people having public conversations. Like even in your own home, if somebody gets a cell call, like, you know, somebody calls you on your cell phone, then step outside, right? So you know, just public communication. You're standing behind me in the grocery store having a full on conversation. And then she said, did you see her dress? And you're like, oh my gosh, right? It's not like you can't wait 2 minutes.
Well, but then so you want to see her dress too. I mean, it's, then they've looped you into it.
Yeah. I'm a big person of, you know what, the cashier gets my full attention and you're out, you're there for a reason, interact with other human beings. So I think when you're surrounded by people, give them attention.
Right. Yeah. Stay focused. How about quirks? How about, is there something about your personality that, and I'm not going to let you say all the productivity and time management expertise in a different vein. Is there something about your personality that somebody's called you out on before that's a little bit quirky, but it's who you are? It's, you know, you're like, you're not going to change. You take pride in it. Just a little quirky.
A little quirky. Oh, let me think. I'm pretty boring. In my family.
Okay. I'm just going to edit out that answer. No, I'm just kidding.
No, in my family, like I've got a sister who every day when she went to school, if you didn't have breakfast with her and she was missing, you wouldn't know what color her hair was. Right. So somebody had to be like, did you have breakfast with her? So I was always a straight laced, boring person. I guess I'd need a better definition of what quirky is, like something that I do or like a habit I have.
So I'll give you some examples. So some people, well, it's almost like, and I have a lot of these, but it's almost like OCD type things that comes up a lot, like things you kind of like always do about your personality or about your routine. So for me, for example, like, and I get this from my dad and my grandpa Fred, we joke that, you know, as my dad was experiencing more of this, and I'm like full blown, we call it emerging Fred syndrome. Because what it is like, even if we're at somebody else's place or at a restaurant or something, if like a painting is a little uneven or if like somebody's like cupboard doors open or closets open, something like that, we like have this urge to close it or fix it or straight. Like it's like this little kind of, I don't know if it's technically OCD, but it's like OCD type things that, so anyway.
Yeah, I think recently I was concerned I might have to go into rehab for Lysol wipes, but I just really like when you clean with them and you can see the dirt.
Yeah.
So I've had to sort of slow down on like, okay, you got to get a grip. And it's, I don't, you know, I know not to clean other people's houses, that's fine. But I do think I'm borderline. I have some borderline mental health issues with the fact of like, oh, I can dust that and I can dust that. So that's been my most recent obsession, I would say. Oh, okay.
Well, that's a good habit to have because you're just making everything cleaner. So that's good.
Yeah.
Sponsored by Lysol. How about weird talents? Is there something that you're really, really good at, but it doesn't really have an impact on your business? So like, maybe it could be like, you're really good at memorizing something, or maybe you're just like,
I have a bizarre memory. My husband used to say that I remembered every day of my life since the day I was born. I have a like ridiculously phenomenal memory. Like I can remember things I dreamt about in kindergarten or a color of a shirt you were wearing the first day I met you, like in grade four.
Really?
Like, so I have a very accurate memory. Like people from far and wide will, if they're having a discussion over something, we'll call Kris. And I'll be like, no, that was a Tuesday. Cause remember it was raining and the flights were canceled and we had this for lunch. So yeah, I have a bizarre memory.
Wow. Yes. I mean, there's people that have that have been like showcased on the news and talk shows and everything. Do you have it like down to specific dates? Like if I name a date?
No.
No, so it's not that, but it's different.
No, I can remember the details of the event, but I don't remember days and numbers. Like, you know, I can tell you it was a Thursday, but I don't remember. I'm not like to be studied, but I do have a bizarre memory, which people have pointed out then is not helpful if we're having a discussion because I am right when it comes to the details. Yeah.
Okay.
So, you know, I just remember anything I've experienced. If I was there, I remember all the details about it. Yeah.
Cool. So I'm excited to reconnect in the future and for you to detail everything that went on today, the day of recording.
Yeah.
Okay. So only a little bit of time. Wrap up. Let's wrap up with a little bit of rapid fire Q&A. You ready for it?
Okay. I think so.
All right. So you are really, really good at time management, but I find it fascinating that you don't wear a watch and you don't use an alarm clock. So what is your favorite type of clock?
Favorite type of clock? I guess I just set alarms. I don't have clocks, really. There's no clocks here. Yeah, I just set.
So you just use your phone, you mean?
Yeah, like I'll just say, you know, what time is it or whatever. But and I just set timers for when I'm going to do something. So I really don't have a lot of. I don't find that soothing when you go into somebody's house and think it's designed and they got that big mother of a clock. Oh, I find that very stressful. So that's not me. I don't have clocks hanging on the walls. Yeah.
Gotcha. Okay, you're not like a time traveler or anything. No. How about what is the hardest you've ever laughed?
Hardest I've ever laughed. Oh, I remember that. Yes. Do you want the story?
Yeah, sure. I mean, if we go longer, I'm gonna blame it on you though. So you can't kick me off.
The hardest I ever laughed was one time my husband was making tacos. He put them on his plate and he put four on my plate. And he was very methodical. Like he was dressing his, put the cheese and then put the meat. And he was doing this whole process. I don't have time for that. When you put food on my plate, I want to eat. So I made one taco, removed the other three from my plate and ate the taco. And he looked up when he finished this ridiculous exercise of dressing four at one time. And he screamed at me because he said, "You're going to make yourself sick," because he thought I ate all four, but I'd only eaten the one because I don't have time to dress all four and then start eating, right? So he thought I had consumed four completely dressed tacos in the amount of, like in another minute or two. And I was laughing so hard, I couldn't tell him that I hadn't. They were just off my plate, like while I ate, right? So I don't know if that story articulates well when I'm trying to describe it, but.
No,
I thought that was hilarious.
Yeah, that's great. Now I'm like hardcore craving tacos because I would have been the person that like actually did eat four in a minute. So
yeah, like I like to eat, but I couldn't dress them all and eat four in the amount of time that he did that. So yes, I am known for when it's time to eat, let's eat. But that was a bit of extreme. Yeah.
Yeah. Tacos every day, as far as I'm concerned. And then if you had a big fight, a big brawl in an alley with somebody and you could only bring one sidekick, you could bring one superhero along with you. What superhero would you bring to your fight in the alley? Which I'm sure is a very true story.
Well, that's funny because I was actually raised in martial arts and taekwondo. So when you said sidekick, I thought I was going to pick a kick.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Pick so a kick, pick a clock, you know.
Yeah. So I grew up in martial arts. So I guess, I like to be positive and passive about stuff. I'd get Superman, just let's fly out of here. We don't need conflict. We don't need drama. Yeah.
Faster than a speeding bullet.
Yeah, well, there you go.
Well, Kris, I know you got to run. Thank you so much for coming on the show and sharing all of your time, wisdom, and your stories about tacos and everything, all your brilliance and your amazing book. So thank you so much for coming on. Where is the best place for people to find your book and also to connect with you?
Yeah. So you can check us out at Win the Hour, Win the Day. You can reach out to me on Facebook or LinkedIn, and you can also check out our podcast called Now Your Business. So those are a couple of places you can get to know me better. And definitely reach out on LinkedIn and send me a message or on Facebook and say you heard me on this phenomenal show. And I'd like to know where you heard me from and what you heard. So I would love for your listeners to reach out.
Of course. Oh, well, thank you so much. It's phenomenal. Now I'm crying. So thank you very much. And last thing here. Final thoughts, stage is yours. It could be a quote. It could be music lyrics. It could be a random memory that you have from, you know, June 14th, 2000. No, I'm just kidding. Whatever you want. Final thoughts. Send us off here.
I just think business should be fun.
That was fun indeed. Thank you, Kris, for coming on the podcast and sharing your story. And thank you, Wild listeners, for tuning in to another episode. If you're craving more wild stories like this one, make sure to subscribe to this podcast on your favorite app and leave us a 5-star review on Apple Podcasts. You can also absorb more creative marketing and business growth stories and resources at hippodirect.com/blog and hippodirect.com/newsletter. That newsletter is the Hippo Digest and is your place for wild marketing ideas every single week. And of course, come join the conversation on social media at the handles HippoDirect and Max Branstetter. Until next time. Let your business run wild.
Bring on the bongos!